prepared speech. We have a very special session on education session about how to go about speaking in front of Toastmasters or public speaking. We have this Toastmaster Vidya Sridhar, who is a principal scientist at Kevin Care and working in the dairy and beverage R&D. And she says, without a smile, you cannot win anyone. It brightens your day and also the other person's day. Please put your hands together and welcome Toastmaster Vidya.
I see a lot of youngsters in the crowd and our guests too. So even though it's a small group, I think it's a great group to bring about any kind of education. Today my topic is how to use body language. And just going to write something. So there is one scene that I want to just write. The language of body. While you read that, I just want to ask, how many, I'm sure a lot of youngsters here, how many of you are very versatile with WhatsApp? Yeah, I'm versatile with WhatsApp. No? Okay. How many of you are versatile with messages, SMS, now that WhatsApp has come, it's a different kind of thing, you know, the phone messages. So there are some few of them. Mostly WhatsApp, right? Now, how many of you really pick up the phone to call somebody? Oh, good number. Not bad. So how many of you really go see the person when you want to meet somebody? Very few. Very few.
They all live near my house.
No, it's true. The world is now, before the world was all about emails, right? Before maybe 1900s, early 1900s, there was no communication. When I was growing up in 1980s, okay, my father was in Dubai. And the only time is once in a month, we would have to go to this auntie's house and stand there and sit there for a while until he would call us from Dubai. And it would be an STD call and you'd have to pay money to this auntie to even receive the call. And we would talk to him just to hear his voice, because he would come once a year to visit us. So he would do once a month a call to listen to his voice. This was how it was in 1980s. And then we had our own phone in our own house and we were able to call him in 1990s. That was itself a big money, because when I went to the US in 1996, I would never call my mom on a weekly basis or even on a monthly basis. It would be a lot of money to call. So I would do letters, writing letters. How many of you write letters now and send it by post? Anybody? By email, right? Non-verbal communications are the way of the world now. How many of you agree with that? Non-verbal. That is the way now. People don't want to interact with people. They just want to do a message and say, yes, I'll come home. Even if your wife is sitting right next in the other room and your husband is on WhatsApp or Twitter, hubby, dinner is ready. Oh, I'll be there. That is how they do it now. That is how the world's changing. And I feel that body language, which is part of this, the language of body, which is the key to unlock the soul, that's missing, completely missing. In our day-to-day life, a husband and wife or a daughter and mother, my daughter is always on the phone, you know, playing games or seeing TV or doing something on the computer. They hardly listen to you. They hardly listen to you. There were times when we would be looking at our moms and dads when they would be talking to us. And now the kids hardly look up and see when we're talking at them. this is very true, this is happening in my house. How much ever I tell them to take the phone, put it down, look at me when I'm talking to you. Where is the eye contact? Is there an eye contact? It's been either a disrespect or it's just that they're too busy to even think about seeing you. So I'll be telling you certain things that are powerful communication tips without which you cannot connect to the audience. And that is body language. And body language doesn't have to be grave and, you know, sounding very serious and you have to listen to me. And it can be fun. It can make the audience come along with you. It doesn't have to be serious at all. It has to bring the audience to move away from that phone that Mr. Thomas is working on and look at me. That is how motivating it has to be. It has to be in such a way for every person in the household when that child is looking at the phone or looking at the computer and the husband doesn't have time but to just see Twitter, what is the world saying about, oh, this and that, but look at his wife and appreciate what she's trying to say. So that is the power of body language. That is the connection you get when you connect with the audience. And I would like to give you some tips on that today. The first thing in body language that people talk about, there are many things. I'll divide it in simple terms for you. The first thing is stance. When you come onto the stage, so somebody calls you and they invite you, when you come, that brief movement shows confidence and it shows that you can do it. Yes, you can, right? Obama's, yes, you can. So you just walk up and you shake, you give a firm handshake and you come on stage with confidence. That means no slouching shoulders, all right? And no seeing down. Your eyes should always see up. Your shoulders should be broad and you should show that, yes, I can do this anytime. You call me anytime and I can do it. And that is stance. That is all about stance. It shows confidence and relaxation. You should not show nervousness, which is fidgeting, talking with pacing, you know, putting your finger, you know, swaying from one another, or just going about and talking. This is all not stance. This is more stance. It should be either in one place, stand and address. If you want to move, you move to another place and stand and address. You should not be moving and, you know, brisk movements, or even in the same movement, you should not be doing the swing, you should not be slouching, you should not be looking down, you should not be, you know, looking here or there. It should be more to the point, either to the audience or to the person you're talking to. But the stance should be with confidence and at the same time, relaxation. So that's one. The second one is body language. So what is body movement, all right? So movement within the stage. This again, you might say, what is the difference between stance and movement? Movement, stance is about your posture, your poise and your presence. Whereas movement is any part of the body that you use to communicate a certain idea. That is movement. Now sometimes people do this without thinking and it is more a part of their way of talking, alright? So sometimes people will, as I said, pacing and moving around in the stage, all that is part of movement also. People think that, oh, now I should not stand in one place, so I should keep moving. So they just keep moving without a thought to the movement. You should move only when you have a different point to say to the audience or you have a transition in your speech. So let's assume you can think it like a paragraph. Just like a paragraph in any English is differentiating one thought from another thought, similarly you should think, oh, I should do that movement only when I go from one thought to another rather than in the same thought I'm moving around and talking. That's very distractive. So instead of that, you talk, you address, and then you again talk on another point, you come to a different stage. So you cover the area, because a lot of people say you don't cover the area and you won't get to. you know, you don't get to impress. If it's a big audience, you don't get to show them. You turn yourself and talk to that group, and then turn yourself and talk to this group. So that kind of thing you can do by using the space that you've given to yourself. The other thing you do, other time you do movement, is when you ask a question. So when you ask a question to the audience, you have the chance to come closer to the audience and I say, hi, so did you understand what I'm trying to say? So you're coming closer to the audience and pointing to a particular listener or a group of listeners, and you're asking a question. If it is a big audience, you can even shout out and say, that section, do you understand? But still, you come closer to the audience. And that movement is when you ask a question. But the movements have to be purposeful. That is the idea. It should not be without a purpose. So you should have a purpose to move on the stage, and you should do it with either a transition in mind, or if you ask a question, or in another movement you can do is when you are really enacting something. For example, the GE was enacting today a two-person communication, and she stood on one side and she said, you have to do this way and that way, and then, you know, she moved, and you can talk about the person who's listening to her. You can move this side and say, you can enact as if you are the person she's giving feedback to, and this is the person who is the evaluator. At that time, you can move. The other thing for body language, the most critical one, is gestures. And many people get confused about gestures. They either use it too much or they don't use it in the right manner. For example, some people have, if you don't use your hands, you're better off holding them together and standing in front and talking, rather than having it free and doodling it around your face. Because this people do very often. They keep talking and, you know, they don't realize it. They keep moving their hands and, you know, it's all over them. So if you feel you are that kind of person, just try to fold it together in front of you and talk. And use your gestures only to imitate a certain thing. For example, direction. That person went there. When he shouted, I was here, or something like that. So you have to, you can use that for gestures, or even you can use your hands and things like that to say, very good, or, you know, if you don't agree, that's not right. And these kind of powerful, angry, you know, confirmation, or open hands is more about generosities, and, you know, closed hands is about anger and purpose and power. Yes, we can. These are the powerful gestures you can use with your hands and also with your whole body. There was an enaction in the storytelling I was doing, and I was trying to enact an old lady as a witch, and I used that. I moved around with my body movement as well as, and I was shivering like the old lady and telling kids, get to listening to the story will be impressed. They'll say, ah, oh, this is really like an old lady. She's bending her back and, you know, moving around. So that is something you can use too for your gesture. The other thing that is very important is facial expression. Smile sparkles. It's very true in body language. Without a smile, how can you win the audience? You have to smile. But I've seen in many speeches, people keep smiling. They're always smiling. Whether the paragraph talks about a road accident, it's like, the car met with an accident. That's not how you say it. You have to get into it and say, the car met with an accident. They had a fractured leg. It should show the concern in that accident rather than smiling and being brave and, yes, I can do it. The other time, just to give you an example, when you are evaluating somebody and you are trying to say, by the way, you didn't do that, you know, you had a small mistake. If you keep smiling and saying that, that other person will think you are jeering at him. Rather than that, if you show it some concern, but, you know, you could improve in that, and you show that sincerity in your speech, they will buy it. They will be more, you are more empathizing or sympathizing with them, and that has more score than always being nice. So those are some things with your facial expression. And if you are not good at it, you can look in the mirror as a practice and you can go through it, you can rehearse, you can look in the mirror at yourself. Are you really showing the right expression? Or are you really jeering? Or are you really... Practice makes a man perfect, right? So you can revel in your own talk by looking at the mirror and trying to imitate what you're trying to say. The other thing about the last thing that is very important in body language is eye contact. Eye contact is the most important thing in body language. The reason why you meet a manager and there is more effect than emailing him or WhatsApping him or SMSing him is that you sit in front of him and you look at him. You look at him, or you look at your daughter, you look at your husband, and you sincerely say your point. And that eye contact makes a huge difference. A huge difference in the way you communicate your point. There have been many meetings in my life, in profession and personal, where people have misunderstood me left, right, and center. And the only way I've saved that is by meeting them in person and sincerely talking it out to them and explaining the reason, and they were able to buy my idea. So this is one of the important things of body language. So again, recap. Stance.
Body language.
Movement. Purposeful movement. Confident stance. Facial expression that is right for that particular expression. Gestures that are also purposeful and apt for that particular idea. And what else?
Eye
contact. So I hope you all do well. To the next time. Thank you.